I like balls. We love balls. I think that's a motto for this channel at this point. In fact, I love balls to the point where I like to save the balls. Now, if you want to wonder where I got this epic shirt from, it's my friends over at Manscaped.com, long-term partners of ours. And the reason we're doing this is because April is Cancer Awareness Month, especially for the testicular region. Now, you know that every hour, one man every day is actually diagnosed with testicular cancer. It's a pretty scary thing. Cancer itself, it's scary. Last time I Googled it, and I'm surprised it hasn't been canceled. Now, ladies and gentlemen, for me, cancer is a real personal deal. I am not going through it, thankfully, but I know a few family friends who are going through cancer. Not necessarily of the testicular variety, but cancer in general is just scary. It breaks families, it ruins the mental state of the person that they're going through, and the people that survive through it have a lot of battle scars to deal with going forward. And this is why this integration itself is incredibly important to me. You know that I'm a huge fan of Manscaped products. I use their Perfect Package Kit. I mean, god dang, do I like caressing my balls with luxurious ingredients right there. I mean, it's just the perfect end to a beautiful day. Now, while you're sitting at home using the crop preserver, ball deodorants, and the ball wipes, you can actually caress your balls and really detect these early signs right there. If you go to manscaped.com/TCS, they've got some programs where you can check yourself for early signs of testicular cancer. As always, you can use code SOMEORDINARY for 20% off and free shipping at manscaped.com. Every purchase at Manscaped goes towards contributions at the Testicular Cancer Society. Join the Manscaped movement and don't forget to take care of your pair. I really don't want to have to make this video. God, I wish I had a cute puppy to show in this. Ladies and gentlemen, I offer an apology. I, Mudahar Anas, offer a toast to Apple. All right, ladies and gentlemen, all jokes aside, I do actually offer a solemn apology to Apple. Now, up until this point, I basically rip on Apple because they're an effectively easy target in the tech industry, and I think most people on YouTube do. They're not just an easy target, but they're a target that makes plenty of mistakes when it comes to at least some form of engineering or design on their systems. Now, full notice, I'm not somebody that dislikes the iPhone. I consider the iPhone to be a pretty good device from Apple. I don't dislike the iPads. I think they dominate in the tablet industry for a reason. I actually love the Apple operating system, okay? I use it on Hackintoshes all the time. Now, because Apple decided this time, enough is enough, no more Mr. Nice Simp, they decided, you know what? We're going to actually go and design our own system from head to toe. See, up until this point, Apple, when it comes to their MacBooks and iMacs, I've always ripped on. And hey, now, to give them credit, they've gotten a lot better at pricing some of their higher-end products, but because of their ties to Intel, you could buy an equivalent PC for actually cheaper with Ryzen processors and NVIDIA GPUs and absolutely outclass the system. And for the laptop side that we're looking at, yeah, at least Intel-wise, they're priced up the ass, in my opinion. But when it comes to their M1 lineup, they're getting a lot better and competitive, and we're going to look at that through the video. That isn't to say the laptops are completely innocent. They come with a lot of severe problems as well. A minimal amount of RAM in comparison, an absolute processor that gets thermal throttled because Apple likes to make their products look really tiny and fit high-end processors, and hey, if it gets hot, which it will, we don't care, who gives a shit. Their GPUs are dog in comparison, and they price them through the roof. Now, that hasn't really changed, but Apple has decided to, instead of going to Intel, instead of going to AMD, we're just going to do the whole thing ourselves. So they have their own processor, their own GPU, and the reason I'm making this video is because, listen, I love technology. I like to look at the forefront of tech. So I decided to put my own money on the line. Yes, I made the payment. I got the receipts to prove it. I've actually put my cash on the line, the MacBook Pro, and I decided, hey, is it going to actually be good this time? Now, before I get into the glory hole that is this video, we're going to look at some real negatives, okay? One of the real negatives is trying to buy the product, okay? So here we're going to go to the Demon's Taint right here, which is Apple's website. Of course, they're pimping out the iPhones, but if you look at the top, you can be reminded that, yes, in fact, they do sell Macs. So let's go to the Mac section. Of course, they've got a whole lineup here. Welcome to the future of Mac. Learn more about M1, which is the processor we're talking about. Now remember, Apple has switched from x86 to ARM. x86 is what's running on our gaming computers. It's what's running on most laptops. It's basically where desktop and laptop computing is. ARM is a different processor type that's very popular in smartphones and tablets. So Apple has decided, hey, we already have a good processor on these devices. Why not try to bring that to the desktop industry? And if it's anybody that can do it, it's Apple, because Apple is the only group out there that I've walked into literal Starbucks and I've actually met people who are like, wait, what's a Windows? I see Windows on the store. That's a cute penguin you have on your computer. What's Linux? These people are all about Apple. They got the brand power to make this happen. So anyways, back to their website. Now, of course, they're trying to sell you a MacBook Air. We're not going for the Air. We're going for the Pro, baby. We're not even going for the Mini. What do you think we are? Now, of course, they're pricing it at $1,699. It's not cheap by any standards, but it's better pricing than what Apple is doing. Now, if you go to the buy page here, you can see that I have a 13-inch and a 16-inch. All right, obviously, for a Pro user, I wanted the 16-inch. Here's the best part about the 16-inch. They don't even sell you the M1 Mac that they're pushing like crazy. They sell you the Intel version of it. Now, I don't know if this has to do with an Intel, like, licensing agreement, but if you look at the i9 processor price and the AMD Pro 5500M that they're pushing out to you with 4 gigs of GDDR6 memory, 16 gigs of DDR4 RAM, and a terabyte SSD, $3,500 Canadian, okay, which is like $5 US, still pricey. If you go to their section, you can't even get their processor. What is this? Why would you sell a Pro product, Apple, if you're not even putting it into your big, giant thing? Maybe it's a licensing agreement, I've got no idea. If you go to the 13-inch side, which is what I had to go to, they had the M1 chip in 256 gigs and 512. Now, I picked the 512 version. I initially wanted to get the 16 gigs of unified memory, okay, which is 250 extra. I could have paid for the extra SSD storage. Didn't really feel like it. Except I realized I had to wait like 4 weeks to pick this bastard up. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to get, believe it or not, the original 8-gig one. So, again, I just want to remind you, Apple is also a company that's trying to sell you a, I fucking shit you not, a USB-C to USB adapter for $25. Okay, so their pricing is kind of all over the place, but you can get this a lot cheaper at Amazon with more USB hubs. Don't you dare fall for Apple's bullshit. But anyways, I decided to buy this system. Now, with this unified system, another big problem is if you watch Lewis Rossman, who's a great channel, great content creator, he'll probably tell you and agree with me that trying to repair this bastard is going to be very difficult. Since this is all Apple's design, repairing this is just not going to be a simple feat, okay? It's not going to be a simple feat of engineering. Understand that. This thing is an all-in-one. If it fucks up, you're going to have to take it right back to Apple, and you're going to have to take the fisting they're going to deliver to you, so just understand that. But now that all the negatives are sort of taken aside, and yes, that is all the negatives I've actually had, let's get in to testing this out. Is this the future? Did I get screwed over? Well, let's see. Now, for $2,000 versus the near $4,000 that I was going to put into it, first things first, there's been a lot of benchmarking done by Linus Tech Tips and many other people out there that have favorably compared this M1 processor to the i7 variant, in some cases actually beating the i7 version of the Mac. Now, I personally find benchmarks to be a little disingenuous when you have two different architectures going up against each other. But with Intel's case, when they were showing some of these benchmarks, let's be real, they're using benchmarks that are more optimized to their systems anyways. To be honest with you, I'm a man that prefers real-world performance, so let's chill out and see some heavy tasks. Let's see how this ARM processor stands up to the big brothers that it hopes to overthrow. So let's get through the heavy tasks. Gaming. Yeah, I know some of you come here to watch some gaming from time to time. I know gaming is a pretty important thing. Can the MacBook M1 game? Yeah, sure it can. Now, I've been one of those people that has laughed at Apple for its gaming performance, but can I just tell you right now, it's not the hardware's fault. Now, it's the software fault. Believe it or not, the system actually can game, okay? Basically, the system that Apple is using to sort of hold the transition between this new processor architecture is something called Rosetta 2. Basically, Rosetta 2 allows you to run current applications that couldn't run on ARM onto the system, kind of like a translation layer. This is how we're going to get running most of the heavy programs that we have that haven't been ported. Even programs like Spotify and Discord that don't actually have proper ports yet are running exclusively through Rosetta 2. Now, for all credits given, Rosetta 2 works nearly perfectly. I haven't encountered a crash or any issue. It's almost as if these programs were actually designed for this new processor type, but they aren't. So, kudos to Apple's engineering team. You did a great job on the software division there. Now, this is where you split this whole section up into categories. If you know your game has a Mac version, then it'll run just as you would expect. Games like Fortnite run absolutely fine. 60 frames, it dips down to 50, but overall, it's actually playable. And remember, this is unoptimized code running on an entirely different architecture, for mobile devices, no less, okay? So imagine if this was given desktop-level power and cooling and everything, this might even be pushed a little bit further. Now, you can also run games like Borderlands 3 around 720p with 30 to 40 frames. Again, it's unoptimized code on a brand new GPU type that Apple has made. And it runs relatively well. Remember, this thing is not getting hot at all. Like, as far as thermals are considered, all of this video, everything that I've done, does not push this system to a super hot level. This system runs warm. And it runs warm running games not even designed for its system in the first place. Now, moving on further, let's talk about games that just don't exist on the system. Let's talk about 32-bit applications. Let's say you wanted to play San Andreas. Well, you can't download it off Steam, because that apparently doesn't work. It doesn't allow you to run 32-bit applications for Mac. This is a big problem under Apple, but you can actually download the iPad, iPhone version of San Andreas and hook up a 360 controller and play that. Now, you can sideload other games, because remember, since this is a mobile ARM processor, it has like 100% compatibility with iPhone and iPad apps, which are great. Up until you try running a game like Call of Duty Mobile and end up having your account banned like I did. I don't know why, but I ended up having my account banned, so I don't recommend you try this. Other games like Stardew Valley work perfectly, so if that's the entire scope of your gaming, then congratulations, you're hitting 60 frames on something that can run on Granny's pacemaker. And as far as games like Counter-Strike Global Offensive, it works. A little bit of stutters going on, but it works, that's for sure. Now, moving on further, let's talk about pushing this system a little bit out there. Let's say you want to run games like Witcher 3 or whatever. It's possible using apps like Crossover. Remember, since this is an ARM-based Mac, you can't run Bootcamp and install Windows 10 like you normally would to run those games. So you're kind of limited in that capacity. Or at least that's what I thought. See, I went the extra way and installed a virtual machine. Yes, you knew what channel you were watching when you heard those words. I installed Windows 10 ARM. If you don't know, Microsoft actually makes Windows 10 for ARM processors. It's kind of an insider thing. It's sort of like their beta version of Windows. You can actually download it and try it out for free right now. Basically, by using a tool called Parallels Workstation, which is a virtualization software for Mac, I was able to install Windows and then Steam. And actually, what you're about to see is Yakuza Kiwami 2 running on an actual M1 Mac. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is a pretty big deal. To understand what's going on, I have Windows 10 for the ARM-based processors running underneath a virtualization software. So it's a VM system that has a bit of the GPU pushed from the actual host Mac to the VM, and it has about 6 gigs of memory and all 8 cores passed into it. To understand the magic that's happening, Windows is using its version of Rosetta to convert that x86 Yakuza Kiwami 2 game to ARM, and then under a virtual machine passed back to the Mac, and it's running, not perfectly, but surprisingly it runs, which is already a big deal that I never expected. Games like Yakuza Kiwami run as well, although somehow I'm getting less performance. Now, even games outside of this range can run. But ladies and gentlemen, to understand, this is already better than I expected. Emulator-wise, GameCube runs perfectly. Automata Lista is running at 1080p, which is already blowing my mind with how full speed it is. But PS2 is when things get slightly hazy. See, Macintosh's version of PCSX 2 is so fucking outdated that the last update to it was in 2012. Now, you can get the Git version, but I've had problems connecting a controller to it, which is something that I don't enjoy. So I went the extra way, and under the same Windows 10 virtual machine, I downloaded PCSX 2 for Windows, being translated by Windows 10's ARM processor, or ARM system, and I was able to get Final Fantasy X running at full speed, 1080p, on a Mac M1 through a virtual machine. This is truly a level that I never expected to go that deep in, but it works, and I can tell you 100% that it does. Now, even beyond this, let's say you wanted to play other emulators. Well, SNES, GBA, PS1 all work really well. There's a program called OpenEMU, which I consider to be the ultimate premier emulating software, and it's all underneath Macintosh. It's like a full exclusive to them. And it works as you would expect. The games look great, they run great, and quite honestly, this thing is a relatively awesome gaming powerhouse. It's not perfect, but for a system that's this new, and for a system that is taking such a revolutionary step in its design, I would say that it's better, way better than what I expected. Would I play a game on this normally? Absolutely not. I have a gaming PC for it, but it's pretty impressive to see what this hardware is actually capable of. And this is just the first showcase of Apple's processor. Imagine going forward. Imagine this taking off so well that other companies in the PC space start taking this side of processing a bit seriously. Now, a lot of the issues with the gaming side of MacBooks comes to the point where Apple themselves don't properly support it. Like, unless it's an iPad or an iPhone or even a fucking watch or an Apple TV, yeah, they'll give you Apple Arcade and video games and cool. It's like they completely forgot they had a Mac at all. So basically, the problem here is that you can't have multiple graphic APIs. Like, for instance, unless the game is Metal compliant, which is Apple's own API, it won't run. Macs don't have Vulkan support. They also have a really old version of OpenGL. And here's another big twist. You can't even use NVIDIA GPUs on your Mac at all because Apple and NVIDIA don't get along. So congratulations, we don't even have access to drivers for the operating system. So you're already missing out on a lot of gaming stuff. And that's purely because Apple doesn't want to cater to you on a software level. And they also don't want to cater to you on keeping their platform open to use multiple parts as they see fit. Now, again, that's kind of a positive for Apple in cases, but for you guys and gals who are gaming on these devices, it's a weird moment because you actually have a system that can game, but Apple's consistently fucking you over time and time again so that you can't game. So in that regards, can you game on an Apple new Mac Pro? Yeah, you can, I guess. You know, it depends on what your idea of playable is, but yeah, you can. So now this moves on to the next stage, all right? This is general use, as I like to call it, which is browsing the web, writing emails, writing scripts, having a good time, pretty much what 70% of my day consists of. Now, none of these tasks should really surprise you. At the end of the day, doing this on ARM or x86 is relatively easy regardless of architecture. But one of the advantages that ARM has is, no matter what, we're still running cooler and the battery lives are lasting longer. Now, imagine if you could take this from a laptop and translate it to a desktop. It would be an interesting thing to see 5 years down the road. And I'm glad to see Apple is sort of solving that software solution. And in the same time, so is Microsoft. Remember, we just ran Yakuza Kiwami 2 under Windows ARM. So obviously, both sides of the operating system spectrum are doing the absolute best to transition as quick as they can. I think Microsoft and Apple realize this may be the future of where processing may be headed to. So they're kind of jumping on the curve to at least solve the software gap. All in all, most of the stuff we're doing in this segment is through a web browser, but if we were to actually use software, which in this case, 90% of the things I'm using, like Discord, Spotify, and even Microsoft Visual Studio for programming, rely on Rosetta 2 or some sort of translation layer. And if that works without the user really knowing that it works or the user even figuring it out, it's pretty good. Like, we're getting there. At the end of the day, this is a really good sign towards what the future may be. And this is just kind of the beginning, I have to say. So let's get to the next step. And this is where video editing comes in. Now, video editing is sort of the bread and butter. It's kind of how I get videos up on this channel. You know, we don't just usually record this. We have to put it through software and make it look good, make it sound decent for the most part, and cut out all the times where I stumble upon words like, you know, you're catching me on right now. So video editing is important. And I decided to challenge myself video edit on an 8 gig system for 2 weeks, which I did. And this, I gotta be honest with you, has impressed me. Now, since it's an ARM-based processor, I didn't expect Adobe Premiere to work, but it does. Now, Adobe Premiere comes in two formats for the Mac. It comes in the original and it comes in a beta version. The beta version is designed to be used on this architecture, but I've been facing crashes upon crashes. So we're gonna use the original version, which is running through software like translation, Rosetta 2, by the way. It's unoptimized code. And how did it run? Pretty damn well. I was able to do After Effects work, like putting in a bit of rotoscope and green screens. I was able to edit 4K video and have it render out pretty well. Now, the render times weren't better than my actual system, but that's because this has an RTX 3090 in it, okay? It's going to rip through any video in a matter of minutes. My actual MacBook here rendered an entire 17-minute 4K video in about 13 minutes, all right? That's not bad at all, and that was done purely without connecting it to a power brick. So the fact that it was able to edit a video, to work on all the extra effects, and to render it out without the battery actually dying is something that I'm wholly impressed by. And I consider that since how Apple did this really well, it's probably going to catch on with every other manufacturer out there. You know, it's only time that Windows starts doing it and Linux has already done this that people start switching to this new processor type. And if we can make that transition just a bit easier, this might be the new age of computing. Now, the reason why this is an apology to Apple is that, listen, Apple has decided to actually utilize their hardcore engineering teams to design something that I believe is truly innovative. They aren't the first people to introduce this processor type into laptops or desktops, but they have been the first people to do it properly, in my opinion. This system works, and as far as my main complaints with Apple goes, it's done well. If we wind back this video to the beginning when I was buying these systems, the Intel processors are grossly more expensive. They operate at a slower battery capacity, they operate at higher temperatures, and here you got Apple coming out with their own processor that's alleviating 99% of these issues. So the future of Macs are actually quite healthy. Now, once again, it's not perfect. There were plenty of issues, and I'm sure that's going to be ironed out as the next phases of this processor type come out. But you see, at the end of the day, this isn't really just even about Apple. This is about this specific processor type taken to the next level. Now, ARM systems are getting faster. They're getting stronger. What we just witnessed is a far more efficient, a cooler running chip that's actually matching up to its x86 brethren, which if you asked me a couple years before, may really not have been possible. Like, it would have taken a bit longer. It seems like what happened now is some level of black magic, and it really seems like all the other big tech companies are finally taking on Intel and finally taking on this x86 type and are actually like going at it combatively with ARM processors. So, you know, maybe in the next 5 years, this might be more commonplace. Maybe. We'll have to see. But honestly, from what I just witnessed, it was one of the most solid first attempts that I have to say. And I'm actually really excited to see what Apple does more when it comes to innovating. I think it's kind of stupid when it comes to, like, repairing these devices since they're so, like, uniform and all that. But to be honest with you, okay, you're going to have to take some negatives when you look at the overall positives of this situation. I'm more interested to see what Microsoft is going to do with other, like, OEM manufacturers with ARM processors, given how Windows is and how effective that side of the world is, too. So, yeah, I gotta say, the apology is pretty well deserved. Apple actually did something pretty good, and you gotta give them kudos where kudos is, right? You get the apology. It's time to make it better. But anyways, ladies and gentlemen, that being said, this is a nerdy video from me coming to an end. If you like what you saw, please like, comment, and subscribe. Dislike it if you dislike it. I am out.